Well, are you talking to me? And my mom used to say, if the shoe fits, put it on. Wear it, you know, if the shoe fits, if you hear the Lord, the word, the message speaking to you, put the shoe fit on. Put the shoe, if the shoe fits, put it on. You might think I took OxyContin this morning, but I didn't. Later, next week. Okay, I did consider it though. Jesus, it's his longest, it's his final letter to the churches of Asia Minor. It's directed to the church in Laodicea. That's one of seven churches that he addresses in this series of letters in the third chapter of Revelation. And it's a very important one, like each of them are. And there's something for us to learn about this that it's... We recognize it, but we need to be reminded of it. It's his longest letter, and he says, write this to the angel of the church in Laodicea. I need to borrow someone's handout for a moment. I thought it, that's okay, no, that's fine. You gave me the right one, I just didn't put this on it. So, write this letter to the angel of the church in Laodicea. This is the message from the one who is the Amen, the faithful and true witness. Now, at the top of your handout, just before that, I've captured something, and it's stated pretty simply. Many theologians and church tradition view these seven letters to the specific churches of Asia Minor as also representing seven epochs of church history between Christ's resurrection and his second coming. His final prophetic message to the complacent Laodicean church is also to the end times church of today. So these letters are written sequentially in a way that they're very direct. When you read the letters, you see that here you go, Sharon. They're very specific. They're very specific. Jesus knows the church that he's writing to. He knows the everything. He knows the things they're up against, and he also knows their weaknesses and their ways where they have succumbed to the cultures. There's only one that he has really, really good things to say about. And one of the and interestingly, he acknowledges their poverty. It's in their poverty that their faith is rich and growing, and their testimony is what he's looking for. And this church in Laodicea is quite the opposite of that. And so, having that in mind, that this letter is not only written specifically to them, but we can ask ourselves, are you talking to me? Because it's written to the church in the end times. It's the last letter written to the churches, and do you think we might be in the end times? Any reason to believe that?
Yes.
Yeah? Hey, Bruce, would you mind turning the heat on? It feels a little chilly in here. Anyone feel that? And maybe back there, are you sure you know how to turn that heat on? Okay. Well, we'll figure it out. We'll figure it out. Maybe this will be enough. He says, this is the message from the one who is the Amen. It's the yes. Thank you. That has that other part in it?
Yes.
Okay. He is the yes of God. Everything is yes and amen in God. We say amen at the end of a prayer. And sometimes you might even feel like withholding the amen. You know, I heard what you said, but I can't get on board with that. Has that ever happened to you? There are times when I don't feel like a good conscience, I can say amen to a prayer, to someone's prayer. Sometimes it's hard enough with my own. So, how do we distinguish Jesus? How does he identify himself? He says, I am faithful and true. And what else? He is a witness, a faithful and true witness. He is the beginning of God's new creation. I like the wording that's stated here, because sometimes the way that's stated in other translations makes it sound like he's the first of God's creation, and that's not the case. He's not a created being like angels and animals and people. or the earth itself. He is with God. He is God. He was with God in the beginning. He was God, is God. He was the creator, very intimately involved in the creation. And that's why I want to emphasize this. Whoever is a believer in Christ is a new creation. We're part of that new creation when we're in Christ. Yeah. Yeah. Do you want to be part of a new creation? That new creation he aligns himself with, faithful and true, the amen of God? Heavens, if we're indifferent to that, we're missing the boat. It goes on to say the old way of living has disappeared. Even though we see a lot of evidence of it, we're in the process of sanctification. A new way of living has come into existence. We have a receptivity if we're open to the Holy Spirit, if we're open to the Word of God, which gives us direction. He goes on to say, as he's dictating this letter to John, the Apostle John, on the Isle of Patmos, the last of the living apostles in exile, or his outspoken faith, he says, "Now I know all the things," Jesus is saying this, "I know all the things you do, that you are neither hot nor cold." It's a distinguishing characteristic of the Laodicean church. He says, "I wish that you were one or the other. Be hot or be cold. Don't be lukewarm. But since you are lukewarm, since you are lukewarm water, neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth." He knows Laodicea. He knows the layout. He knows characteristics of it. It didn't have its own water supply. Unlike other cities in the surrounding area that got cool, fresh water from the sources, this one got water that was tainted. It had a chemical taste and smell that would corrode the pipes that they, the clay pipes. You know, and there's evidence today of the clay pipes having like a white film in them. And it had to travel for miles. And so it got, not only came out of the ground hot, but stayed hot in the distance that it traveled. And have you ever turned on a water tap and smelled stinky water? You don't really want to drink that, do you? You'll opt for something else. You don't want to make your coffee with it. It's hard enough, bad enough to bathe in it, but you know, at least you're using some antiperspirant, dial soap or something like that. But he says, since you're like that lukewarm water that distinguishes your city, I can't drink it. I can't take what you represent. I will, since you are like lukewarm water, I will spit you out of my mouth. You're neither hot nor cold. What we're going to see here, I would like you to write in on your first one, is Laodicean churches lack zeal. They're not hot. They're not cold. They're just lukewarm. You just warm the pews when you come to church if you are a Laodicean. You're not really there. Your heart isn't in it. Your lips might move a little bit to the song, but you're not singing them. You're not really listening to the words, much less taking it in and examining yourself by the truth of God's word, the faithful and true speaker of these words, Jesus Christ. Laodicean churches lack zeal. They're not hot. They're not cold. These are people, and you know what? Are you talking to me? Am I preoccupied? Am I too preoccupied with other things, with lesser things, to really be attentive to the call? To why I'm here? You might think you're here to do your thing. That's not the whole story. Are you preoccupied? Are you self-satisfied? Is good enough just good enough? Sometimes we have to settle that. Sometimes we have to lower our expectations and the things we're doing, and we have to say, good enough. But being self-satisfied and saying good enough is not good enough. Not if you are in this process of sanctification, working out your sanctification with fear and trembling, with reverence, with this is hard, but this is right. Or if you're indifferent to God's high calling, they're all saying the same thing. Neither hot nor cold, black and sealed, preoccupied, self-satisfied, and indifferent to God's high calling on your life. Well, if I say your, I'm not exclusively doing this. No, it's all these others are pointing at me. Whatever. You know what I'm talking about.
Yeah. That's it.
So would you write those things in if you have a handout and you have a pen? So I'm going to paraphrase Jesus. And he's saying essentially, you're worthless to me and my purposes. Isn't his message to the Laodicean church needs to be taken as a harsh, straightforward admonition, a confrontation, because what's happening to them? They are perishing. Many have already perished because they have abandoned the faith. If I continue to paraphrase the church and use a metaphor that Jesus uses, whose church is it? My church. I will build my church, not your church. You are the church. We are the church. I will build you, and the gates of hell will not prevail against you, against us. But he says, my church, my bride, you offered no comfort when I was cold, no refreshment when my lips were parched with thirst, neither hot nor cold, to meet the needs. And where do we get this? I mean, I personalize it for Jesus saying it, because he talks to, in a parable, to people who say, well, Lord, didn't we do this and didn't we do that and so on and so forth? Aren't we great? And he said, no, I never knew you. And then he said to the others, you gave me something to eat when I was hungry. You clothed me when I was naked. You came to me and visited me in prison. So Jesus personalizes all of this, what we do out here, into other people that he would like to consider his church and his bride. We're our witness a little different. He can't say to the Laodicean church, he can't say that, you weren't there when I was in need. You weren't there when they were in need. You weren't there when these people I wanted to bring in close were in need. You were not a witness, not my kind of witness. He said, my church, my bride, I give you that one again. Why did she leave me feeling sorrowful and sick to my stomach, that I would spit her out of my mouth? Second, number two, deceived, so easily deceived by comfort and prosperity. The Laodicean church was deceived by comfort and prosperity. They were disengaged, self-sufficient, and blind to the emptiness of their godless values. Jesus, the giver of life, pronounced them DOA. You know what I'm saying, right? Dead on arrival. You've heard of red-hot churches, red-hot faith, and you've heard of dead churches. Which one would you like to be recognized as? We got some distance to go. I have some distance to go to be the kind of believer that Jesus is calling for, that would put it all on the line. That my life is not the most important thing. Preserving my life is not the most important thing. They were a very wealthy area. Very wealthy. They were deceived by their comfort. Don't we all look for ways to do more? I just asked for the heat to be turned up so we wouldn't shiver. Yeah. We don't want to be out of our comfort zone. And you know, when do you fall asleep? When the heat's on or when it's cold?
Oh, man.
Yeah. What's that?
I like it when it's cold.
I do. Nancy opens the door and turns the fan on. dead of winter.
Yeah.
But if I'm sitting there in the front row and it's warm, I'm a hug.
That's why you're sitting there.
That's why I'm sitting. That is exactly why I take the front seat here. But we're deceived by comfort in our pursuit of comfort. And so the question then again, are you talking to me? Am I deceived by my comfort? Am I deceived? Do I want more of the world when I have more disposable income? Heck yeah. Yeah, there's things I felt like I've done without it now. There was just a little more disposable income. I could live so much more comfortably. Are you talking to me? The deceived righteous Mises prayer, if you will. Here's a Pharisee who stood and was, Jesus gives this as a parable, but he's observed it. The Pharisee stood and was praying this to himself, God, I thank you that I'm not like other people, swindlers, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. The tax collector who came in humble and beat his breast and said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. The Pharisee said, I'm so glad I'm not one of those. He was deceived. He was deceived by his prestige, his position, his power, and no doubt a certain amount of wealth as well. You see, this is Jesus speaking this to John to deliver it to the church. You say, I am rich. I have everything I want. I don't need a thing. I remember somebody coming who was coming to the church for a while, and they seemed to want to impress me with their money. And one time they even gave me money. I said, no, you put that in the offering. You don't give your money to me. And they came in and they had a bankroll. A bankroll is something that's very visible, isn't it? I mean, who pulls their money out in a roll where you can just send it off and it's big bills? I don't. But this person did. He wanted to give some to me. What do you suppose he was trying to do? Impress me,
influence,
buy me, yeah, earn favor, influence, bribe. You say I'm rich, I have everything I want. I don't need a thing. In fact, and I believe it was 60 AD, that you've heard this in previous messages, that there was a battle. Earthquake that destroyed so much of that Asia Minor area of Turkey. And these magnificent cities and structures were all built out of stone and masonry, and they all collapsed, and the builders came down. And there was the last city we looked at, Thyatira, I think. They were afraid to go back into the city because of the aftershocks. It kept on coming. It was an unsafe place to be. Well, when this happened in Laodicea, Rome said, hey, well, we'll come and we'll help rebuild you. He said, we don't need you, Rome. We can do this ourselves. We got the means. We got the manpower. We can afford to do it. We don't need you. There might have been reasons that they don't want to be beholding to Rome, but the point is, we can be the kind of people that we don't need a thing. Last week, Ron played the song, Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour. We need you. They didn't sing that song in the Laodicean church. Say, I'm rich. I know everything. And you don't realize that you are wretched, miserable, and poor, and blind, and naked. Another thing that Laodicea was notable for was an eye balm, a salve, a healing balm, and perhaps it was part of their economic wealth. People came there because they could get this healing balm for their eyes. But Jesus, knowing so much about who they are and what they put their confidence in, and able to use these as ways to reach them, he says, you don't realize that you're wretched. In my mind, in my sight, you're wretched. I spit you out of my mouth because you're not hot. You don't warm people when they're cold, and you're not cold, you don't parch the thirsty lips. You're wretched, you're miserable, you're poor and blind and naked. The very thing you're famous for is your having this eye salve and being dressed in fine attire and looking like you've got it all together. That's not true about you. No, let the truth be told. Reminds me of the prodigal son. While we're here, being miserable and poor and blind and naked, have you ever had a dream that you were naked in public? Have you? How humiliating. I had that dream, and it's like, oh my gosh, how did this happen, and what do I do now? Do I proudly proclaim it, or do I, is there shame involved? Depends on who you're standing next to. Okay, well, they didn't realize they were naked. They hadn't awakened from their dream to see how foolish they were and how foolish they are, how foolish we are. And I think of the prodigal son. You don't realize that you are poor and wretched and miserable and blind and naked. It speaks to everything about the prodigal who's wandered away from the fullness of the Father and what the Father had for him. That's the son. So I advise you, I got a little bit of advice for you. Buy gold from me, gold that has been purified by fire. It's actually us that he purifies by fire. But Jesus himself went through fire. He didn't need it for purification, but he knew what the effect and what the power of fire and that kind of purification could do. And he said, I want you to have the real thing. Then you will be rich. Also, while you're at it, buy white garments from me so you will not be ashamed by your nakedness. If you can make out the picture, we're looking at the bride of Christ. Yeah, your picture's way better than mine. If you see in the picture, we're looking at that culmination in time where the church represented by the bride is united with the groom, with Jesus. The bride of Christ, dressed in pure white linen. It's a process to get up there, but he's looking for that. Someone said once, you've never seen a dirty bride show up. He didn't come in old slovenly clothes. He goes on, and anoint an ointment for your eyes so you will be able to see. You need to be able to see. You need this ointment that you have over here. I have a spiritual ointment for you. You can only get it from me. But you're blind, you're naked, you're poor, you're wretched. You need what I have because everything you have is a facade. It's counterfeit. Everything we put our confidence in is likely counterfeit for our comfort's sake. I came across this song, Open the Eyes of My Heart, which we all know very well. But it was touching to see it, the rendition by this young man. So.
Christopher Dumpling was born in May of 2001. He's actually the son of my youngest brother and his girlfriend. And when I received a phone call from my brother, I found out that he was born at only 26 weeks, 1 pound, 12 ounces. So he was very premature and he was in critical condition. And there were several nights that we were told that Christopher would make it through the night. And at that point, I prayed for Christopher and I just asked God to be with my brother and to do what his will would be. And for a long time, I had no contact with my brother, really didn't know what happened to Christopher. And all of a sudden, my heart was moved. Where was my nephew? What happened to him? And on my first phone call to social services, the gentleman knew about Christopher, and he indeed was in foster care. He was totally blind. He had been born with cocaine in his system, and he had a host of other medical issues. My first response to that, my first feeling to that, was fear. I prayed very intently, and I really, I beg for God, I said, could you just show me what you would want? And he did, he answered in my heart. He told me, do not be afraid, that I will take care of everything. We've had challenges and we've had joys. One of the greatest joys was to hear Christopher make noise, sing, and keep eating. He really didn't talk till about first grade. So when he sang, it was really neat. It wasn't shortly around that time that we found out that Christopher had perfect pitch. And he started to do remarkable things. And what a joy and what a promise that God gave us that these tears would come and they come with joy. And when Christopher sings, open the eyes of my heart, he changes us to not see everything but to see things that God sees. I want to see you.
So many illnesses, born with cocaine in his system, blind with many other physical conditions. Didn't speak till he was in first grade, but then I can hear through music. God used that. We see a young man who's singing, holy, holy, holy. Now, where do we get that from? In the Bible? In the book of Revelation. Angels, seraphim before the throne of God singing, holy, holy, holy. Nonstop. And we will be brought to a place where that's not boring. Something we do, but we're sitting on the clouds and hearts are being played. We're saying, holy, 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 holy. Those don't make a dent. Those are Laodiceans. But we need to look at this from God's point of view. God didn't bring you this far to leave. We may be Laodiceans in many ways. There may be things where he is talking to me, talking to you, talking to us. God didn't bring us this far to leave us. And I noticed in that song, it just struck me for the first time. Pour out. I want to see you high and lifted up. I don't think the whole Laodicean church said that, sings that, thinks that. They're too distracted, too preoccupied, too many other things. See you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. And then this is what really caught my attention. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. It's when we're in that right place with him, and we're seeing him high and lifted up, and we're looking for him. We're saying, God, open up my heart. Give me eyes. I am poor, blind, wretched, and naked. Open my eyes. I want to see you high and lifted up. I want to say, holy, 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 so you will pour out your power and love, not just on me. It's not just for me. Pour out your power and love on this broken mess, on these people that are dying, these people that are refugees, these people that are living in camps, these people that are escaping, but nobody wants them. Jesus says this, he continues, he says, I correct and discipline everyone I love. I correct them. I correct you. I discipline. I want to make you a disciple. I think this next slide is going to have words that are missing from what I see here. This letter from Jesus to Laodicean believers in all ages, everywhere, is a tough love letter. We use that word tough love, but we also use the term love letter. It's a tough love letter. Thank you, Ted. We always have a spare. It's a tough love letter. Let me see if I can, well, what else is in here? It's a tough love letter.
To the church he loves
and gave his life for. He's writing it, he's dictating, he's giving his last remaining apostle, the one who recognized himself and called himself the disciple whom Jesus loved. Now that might sound arrogant. No, I think it sounds in touch. Recognize Jesus loves me. He's a good, good father. And he's dictating him to him, the last living apostle who's on the Isle of Patmos, exiled for his faith and his witness and his testimony. And he's saying, now I want you to deliver this to the messengers of the churches. Actually, I'll send them to you because remember, you're exiled. I'll make sure that they come to you and you make sure that they bring this message to their congregations. It's what I'm trying to do today. What I want to do today. But it's to all ages, to all people in all ages, everywhere. A tough letter, love letter to all of us. By grace, number four in your handout, by grace, Jesus assures the hope of restoration to his self-examining, repentant disciples. These are the ones who he assures hope to, hope of restoration. If you're not self-examining, you're not going to see your stuff. If you're not self-examining, you're not going to go into recovery. You have nothing to recover from. You're satisfied. You have to be repentant. You have to be willing to turn and go the other way and be more than just a believer, more than just a Christian, because anybody can make that claim. I'm a believer. I'm a Christian. But to be a disciple, follower of Christ, those are the ones that he makes this kind of assurance to. And so Paul tells us, examine yourselves to see whether you are in the faith. Check yourselves. Are you talking to me? Or do you not realize this about yourselves, that Jesus Christ is in you? Unless indeed you fail to meet the test. Or you fail to even take the test. Examine yourselves as to whether you are in the faith. Test yourself. Do you not know yourselves that Jesus Christ is in you? Unless indeed you are disqualified. This question is going to come up later, I believe. We're going to talk about discipline here for a moment. Yet, though, no discipline, it says in Hebrews, it seems pleasant at the time, but painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who have been trained. For those who have recognized, I need to turn and go another way. I want the Father's approval. I don't want to be disciplined and told what I already know. Told what I need to know again. I don't want that to have to happen. I want to be pleasing to the Father. It can be painful when someone judges you for being a true and authentic version of yourself. Let that true and authentic version of ourselves be what Jesus is looking for here. And so he says, so be diligent and turn from your indifference, your disregard, your complacency, and it's all well, good enough. Let it be. It's all fine. He's moving us towards the victory. He's planning for victory for us. And we find this in 1 Corinthians from Paul again. But thank God, he gives us victory over sin and death through our Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, my dear brothers and sisters, be strong, immovable, always work enthusiastically for the Lord. For you know that nothing you do for the Lord is ever useless. Whatever you do, do it as unto the Lord. Not haphazard, not sloppy. Well, I'm gonna shortcut here. I'm gonna keep my finger on the scales a little bit and give a little less than what is due. Jesus continues. He says, "Those who are victorious will sit with me on my throne." Just as I was victorious and sat with my Father on his throne. And then he says, amen, we see this at the end of every letter. Anyone with ears to hear must listen to the Spirit and understand what he is saying to the churches. You might just be listening today, but if you're not taking it in, if you're not saying, are you talking to me? You're not going to get to that place of understanding, which leads to repentance. There's the sorrow, the Bible says, that leads us to repentance. We're sorry for the way we are. We're sorry for being lukewarm. We're sorry, Jesus, for what you've done, that this is what you get. There are the rules of what's great, wealthy city. Laodicea lies in ruins today. And Jesus says, this is my invitation and promise to my Laodicean church. The children I gave my life to save. The bride that I'm looking forward to meet. Here I am. Familiar enough passages. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person. And they will be. That was such a big piece. And it is a meal together. There's an intimacy in having a meal together, and Jesus wants to sit down, just like we see him in the many instances of the Chosen, and just be one with us because we have been drawn to become one with him. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my door, I will come in and eat with that person that they do. You want that? Do you hear that invitation?
Yes.
You need it to be refreshed. This is my invitation and promise to my Laodicean church, even though we are the way he describes Laodicea in so many ways. You're the children I gave my life for to save. And here I am. Wait. But you have to answer the door. I'm not just going to barge in. I'm not going to break the door down. You have to invite me. You have to respond. The Spirit and the bride say, come. I wondered about that. I can understand the Spirit saying, come. How is it that the bride says, come? And I find this, and I think it has merit. The bride is saying, come to the unsaved world. Come. The Spirit is leading. The bride is saying, come. Taste and see that the Lord is good. The Spirit and the bride say, it's an invitation for us then to come to the altar, and we'll do that in our hearts. We'll do that perhaps with our eyes closed, however we do it. It's an invitation.
Are you hurting, broken, thin?
Demonstrate in my body, sacrifice of my body, to come to the altar knowing the arms are open wide. And so if that's you, feel free to come up there. I want to recognize that. I want to lay a hand on you. I want to bless you. Continue.
Forgiveness was born the Jesus Christ.
Lord, help us to receive that invitation, not just here today as we come to, as we are the church gathered in this place, or but let it be that invitation that rings in our ears all the time. If you stand at the door and you call, and that we will answer it and let you in. You want to come and dine with us. You want to sit at the table. You've invited us to your table, your heavenly banquet. You invite us to the altar, a place where we can pour out our brokenness and say, thank you, God. Thank you that I can look beyond. Thank you that there is a hope that you assure me. The promise behind me, I come to you with right heart and attitude. Thank you again, Lord Jesus. We're going to receive the offering at this time. Use this slide to express our hearts. We have victory in Jesus, yeah? You have victory in Jesus. You gotta move into that. You can't just say, yeah, victory in Jesus. Yeah. You gotta move into that. You gotta proclaim that. You gotta say, get today to yourself, I have victory in Jesus, regardless of anything else. I have victory in Jesus. This is how I'm going to love and give. Ain't gonna be the layout of sin no more. Or bless.
Thank you.
Sensitive zeal, or are we looking at a Laodicean congregation? I feel the zeal, and I once again ask, are you talking to me? Lord, have you been talking to me? And he's just going to say, well, he did, put it on. Got a closing song, maybe a couple of closing songs, because what we need to ask, what we need to say, or what we need to praise, Lord, revive the church again.
Thank you.
And don't forget, in the end, Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Lord, thank you for your people. Thank you for your blessings. Lord, thank you for your blessings on me. Thank you for your blessings on us. They don't have that. They wake up and there's rain and they're not prepared for rain. The roof over their head, if they touch it, it's going to rain on them. Lord, we pray for those people. We pray that we would have a heart sensitive, even if we don't necessarily know, even where we don't care. Lord, would you give us eyes to see, open our hearts to see them as you see them and what they do. All these things they don't have, they may not know that they can have your love, but they're going to need people to show it to them. And so, Lord, we pray blessing on them. all your people today.
Tomorrow.
We ask that blessing in Jesus' name. Amen. And Karen, I think I see you with a clipboard. Do you want to come up and say something about that?
Everybody to remember the Caperton family for meals. They're so appreciative. Oh, they can hear me. Can't you?
It's green over here.
Okay, guys.
It's green.
We have quite a few days that could be filled in for the Caperton family. See, it's not good. Yeah. So, if anybody would like to make a meal for them for a day, I've got the list over here. I'll put it over on the office area over there, and you can sign up. If anybody can't, they live in San Juan Bautista. And they're not able to come to church right now. For those who don't know, their son has cancer. He's on hospice, and he's staying at their home with his wife. And then their adult children come to visit them. So they generally have four people in the household, and every once in a while, six on the weekends for sure. So anything, they can have anything. They love food. But the only thing that they can't have is something made with milk. They can have cheese, they can have, all the other things, but it's just something about milk they can't eat.
Shirley, do you want to add something?
No, Karen, will you give Joyce a little testimony about our history with churches? About how the church has responded?
Okay, yes. Joyce, when I took the first meal, and she had tears in her eyes, and she said, you know how long I've been going to churches, and in four different churches, not one ever helped them through a situation and or offered meals, and they were so touched.
Those were big churches. A lot of those were pretty sizable churches.
Yeah, and you would think they would have ministry. Right.
It's so easy to get lost. You fall through the crack, nobody notices that you weren't there. I just would testify too that Nancy and I brought a meal over last week, and we didn't just drop it off at the door, slide it in under the door like the prisoners. We had a great visit with them, and you can't make a whole lot of sense of what Jerry said, but he enjoyed the company, and it was really a rich time to do that. And I don't think you get a whole lot of visitors. And you know what? He does remember. He remembers the work that we did out there. He's telling me something about it. Can't get it together, really. But every little bit helps. And so I would encourage you, according to this list that will spread out the time the food goes there and so forth.
Right. Actually, the other day, because whatever we have or we bring is usually enough to be left over for the next day.
Yeah.
But Joyce is so overwhelmed, she doesn't even think about eating something. And so they weren't eating regular meals. And, with Jerry has dementia, and then with the son with cancer, and not a whole lot of time. And her heart.
Joyce has health issues too.
Yeah.
And allergies to really mess her up. And so here's what worked well. Nancy made a meal to give them that day, and we brought them a frozen lasagna, for that day when there may be a break or a busy weekend or whatever. So, be creative and have fun doing it. Make it enrich the time that you have with them. Lord, we know you're coming back, and we look forward. Was there more?
No, I just wanted to find out exactly how to get where they
live. Okay. All right, I have her address on here. You can take it. Okay, but they're in San Juan Bautista. When you go 156, you turn left there to Solero, and then you go through to not the first left because that takes you back on the highway, but the second left.
Yeah. When you see the cemetery, then just skirt it. Thank you. There's the first driveway once you pass the cemetery.
It's all the same.
Yeah. Okay, one more time, Lord, thank you for your blessings, and we know you're coming back. Help us to be thinking that way, not just as We have an escape route to get away from this, but to look forward to what's in store. We want to know you, Lord Jesus. Give us eyes to see. Open our hearts. Bless you all. Enjoy the snack back there. And then Andy will bring it back together for an episode of Chosen, right?
Yeah, we've got three more episodes. And then the next season launches in theaters.